My background as the president of Polish Service has been quite the journey. And what I have loved about my time with the different companies I've had a chance to learn and grow from is along the way, I've really grasped an understanding of many of the different facets of luxury service in different types of industries. Even though I've primarily worked with hotels and restaurants and spas, what I find is that service has been something that has been very similar. If you go back decades and I pull and dust off a book from a long time ago, some of those same principles that were relevant, back in the 80s and 90s when I was first not even sure what I was going to do with my career, a lot of those same principles come around and hold true today. And that's what excites me about being able to talk about it from this perspective, looking back on the journey through the lens of luxury and what it means to an experience is what I want to share today. The other thing that is going to be one of my goals is just that you leave with some ideas on how to elevate the luxury service you provide in whatever kind of industry that you are a part of. And I think that that's some of the best sharing that I can give from my experience. So if we go into the first slide. So basically, this is one of my favorite sayings that I share with the people that I'm talking to service about. And it says that the most important part of being a leader is maintaining the desire to keep on learning. And that means learning about yourself, about your peers, and about the people that you serve. And this has been such an important saying as far as I'm concerned, because we are all leaders when it comes to the field that we are working and growing and cultivating our craft in. And in the service world in particular, how you deliver that service should evolve and improve with understanding. That's been the whole crux of the business that I've built and the types of work that I do. It's about unleashing the experiences of the persons that I'm working with. And if you are curious, you can stay very curious and you can be very successful learning about the foundations of service and then how to execute on it at a truly masterful level. And so that's why I appreciate this particular saying, because it speaks to the fact that it's nonstop. It's always evolving. No matter whether you are fresh and new in your career or you've been at it for several decades like myself. So what we have here is when I was working with a lot of different companies and I was evaluating what does service mean to the guests, to the customers that it gets delivered to, I started looking at the different providers, whether they be on an individual level or they be at a highly organized level. For example, I always say that I go to a donut house or a grocery store or a gas station and I see 5-star level service. I can find that individual that truly has a passion and a desire to be kind, to be compassionate, to demonstrate a lot of the behaviors that I know are successful. And then at the other end of the spectrum, you have entire companies and hotels and organizations that pride themselves on delivering amazing service and being known for that. And so whether it's on an individual level or a broader level, it has these three elements in mind. And these three elements of artistic, adventurous, and true ended up forming the foundation of my company. Basically, when I established my consulting business, I said, you know what? great service is artistic in a lot of ways. It's almost like watching a symphony or poetry in motion or a dance. It's very seamless and smooth, and it's actually beautiful. It's just well executed. And so that's the artistic part of great service delivery to me. The adventurous piece in a great service culture relates to the courage of the different acts, meaning five-star service, five-diamond service, that top-tier service is very courageous. You take risk when you want to deliver service at that level. And sometimes those risks, you know, result in maybe missing a situation or misstepping. But ultimately, you're going to hit a lot more than you miss when you're actually courageous with your service, thinking out of the box, trying to get ahead of the guest, being very responsive and in a situation that needs our attention, or maybe the recovery effort, you know, goes to a particular length because we really, you know, are upset and disappointed that the service did not meet that guest expectations, and we want that guest to know that we really care. And so that's the adventurous, the courage part of the experience. And then the true part is all about authenticity, because if you have a five-star culture and you have five-star service professionals inside that culture, what I should sense is true, sincere service and authenticity at every step of the experience, every single engagement. And I would never want anyone to be somebody that they're not, because I don't believe that you can ever pull that off. I know that there's great actors and out there. However, people are very smart. They can read sincerity and authenticity. And so that's what I love about these particular foundational principles of great service. I've always felt it's artistic, it's adventurous, it's real. And the next slide. So this was an interesting experiment for me, because when Anthony and I first were speaking about the topic, I thought, well, luxury many times stirs up a particular image. And it might be an image that I tend to personally have a little bit of a love-dislike relationship with, because luxury in its pure form is defined as the state of great comfort and extravagant living, which I think is kind of comical in that it sounds very rich, very formal in a way. And I've always been of the belief, and this has been my evolution as a service professional, that luxury can be a lot of different things. And that's what I want to talk about in the upcoming slides, is I'm almost going to deconstruct this normal definition of luxury and really speak to how it applies and how I've seen it work in a multitude of environments. And that's where the takeaway can be for you, because I'm going to give you some thoughts on how you can deliver luxury service in whatever kind of environment that you're in, like the donut house, like the gas station, like a five-star hotel or a five-diamond resort or a great Michelin-rated restaurant. It encompasses a lot of different things. So let's go on to the next slide. This is luxury redefined, and this is redefined not by anything that you would Google or find necessarily published anywhere, but it's from my heart. And this is what I truly believe luxury is. I feel that luxury is sensory. It's also emotional and it's physical. And you can see I have on there, luxurious acts are executed upon by curious, intuitive staff. Meaning, all we have to do is be awake to our surroundings, and the guests will give us every cue and signal we need to excel. Part of creating a luxurious environment is simply being awake being alert, being attentive, and seeing what's happening. And we move through our days, through the hours of each day, and we are performing in our roles, but there's so much happening around us that I encourage every single service deliverer that I work with to just tune in to what's happening around them, and they will see every single opportunity that can be seized, or they will see the need that needs to be addressed. They will be able to read the guest well and respond appropriately. Great luxury environments have that emotional and physical component as well. And this builds off the fact that it's sensory in nature. And we stir the senses of the guest with quality, understanding, timeliness, and consistency. And what I mean by quality is, think about some of the best restaurants and, you know, resorts that are out there, and there's new resorts opening up all the time, or they're undergoing massive renovations. They change this, they change that. And when they come back, the bones of that structure are many times beautiful. And I think that that's part of it, absolutely part of it, because a luxurious environment does have high quality touches, amenities, technology, different types of things that can be seen, used. But then it's also got the emotional aspect, which is, how did it feel? You know, what was the sense of touch like with the sheets or the linen or the napkin? You know, the flower bouquet. It's creating a beauty with your product and with what your product does. And so luxury redefined to me is a combination of emotional and physical, and it's stirred through the senses. Now, have on here that a luxury culture is extremely proactive. And proactive is one of those words, I have to be honest, that if I had a challenge in my days of training service in the industry, it's almost helping people understand what proactive looks and feels like. Because the word itself, it's very benign. It doesn't seem like it would be very difficult to see or to understand. But in a culture, a service culture, proactivity is action oriented. You know, it's not something that you necessarily read. It has elements of that, but it's more of an act by the service professional. And so this goes back to what I was mentioning about looking for the opportunity. And so there's that fine line also, that a culture should be proactive and attentive, but it shouldn't be hovering. Nobody likes to go into a place of business and be hovered as they're moving about, maybe just browsing and looking for an item. But if you go into a place of business and the staff welcomes you and initiates the greeting and lets you know that they're available and answers your questions thoughtfully and completely and confidently, then that is what I mean by creating that proactive culture. And it's one of those pieces you almost have to immerse into to feel, to really begin to understand what a proactive culture looks like. This is why when I'm working with leaders in the field, I really, if I'm hiring someone to come in and work on a project with me, I like them to come from backgrounds where they have at least experienced a great service culture. You know, it can be from their days of travel. Perhaps they've gone to some places and they understand, you know, what some of those experiences are like. It can be taught. It can absolutely be taught. But I also feel that if you work in the industry, when you're getting experience in the industry, such a big foundation piece of our growth in the industry is taking action and making things happen. And that's part of that proactive piece. Only now we're doing it every single day with every single guest, and looking for moments to intensify the proactiveness in our culture in a subtle way. So that's what I mean by that particular slide. The next slide talked a little bit about, these are some of the points I would love for you to take away, because this is how you can begin to deliver luxury in your particular areas of expertise. Take initiative, lead the engagement. During the pandemic episode that we all lived through, and everything was slow. One of the things, I had to stay busy. I'm just one of those, we work in the hospitality industry. I cannot sit still. So I would go out and just get a lot of different types of jobs. I started working in a lot of different areas. And one of them was actually one of my favorite jobs ever. And I was an Uber driver. And I was just thinking, I love to drive, so why not go and see what this is all about? All I need is a car, and now I don't have to kind of stay in. I can kind of help people get to their places of destination. And as soon as someone would enter a vehicle, my vehicle, I would immediately take charge and I would lead the engagement. Because by doing so, I would understand exactly how they wanted me to treat them, how they wanted me to behave. So that's such a benefit that of taking initiative and creating that proactive, taking that first step. And it also gives you an element of control as well, or guidance. And you can guide the interaction in a way that fits that scenario best. I felt like undercover boss, because here they were being driven around by a 5-star trainer. And I had a very strong service rating, as I better have. But I absolutely loved that job because it gave me a chance to engage. And I realized every single person that I engaged with in the course of a day had a different want and desire from me as far as the way I treated them. And if I got very good at that by taking charge, I was very successful and I had a great time. The other point is to ask questions and learn and understand. And so this goes back to, as soon as they would enter a vehicle, for example, that I would just start talking to them and find out their level of comfort and how much engagement they wanted. And when we are in our worlds, talking to our guests, our customers, our peers, the more questions you ask, the more information, ammunition, data you get to be able to play with. And it helps us learn about them. It helps us get ahead of them because now we know something about them. So if you can master the art of asking questions and be extremely comfortable doing that in your roles, you can actually have an extremely successful career in the hospitality industry. I'm a huge believer that is the number one technique to go after and skill to develop. Number three is to adjust and assume the right emotion. You know, when the guest is giving us some sort of reaction or some sort of idea of how they would like us to be, they're giving us an invitation, essentially. And, you know, we have those guests. When I worked in Las Vegas, working with MGM Grand and different, the Cosmopolitan and Tropicana. And then during my Forbes years of working with different entities out there, it was absolutely amazing to always go into Las Vegas and just realize how much fun everybody there is having, how excited people are to be arriving into that destination. And so I always would tell a front desk agent, a valet attendant, a bell person, you know, by all means, they're almost inviting you, not almost, they are inviting you into that emotion because they want you to be as excited about their trip to Las Vegas as they are. And so I should never have a boring check-in or, you know, kind of a lack of emotion in when I'm in a place like Las Vegas, because everybody there is usually really excited. They're on adrenaline. They eventually get tired because they will have had so much fun, but they ultimately, especially at that initiation point, they are inviting you to get excited for them, for their bachelor party, their gathering with their friends, their shopping trip, you name it. Number four relates to education information service. And what I mean by this is if you're a front desk agent, for example, just staying with that position, that person arriving into to stay with us may not have any idea of our property. They might not have the property knowledge that we have. They may not know of what to do in the area or the activities to that are available to them. And so our goal as service professionals should be to give them just enough information that they can have an amazing time, but leave some elements of exploration involved as well. Exploration or discovery. You know, I love going to a property that has so many things that you can almost find on your own simply by strolling through and maybe reading some of the historical pieces or seeing some photographs of maybe some people that were had stayed there or visited the property before. And so as a leader, as a service leader, whether you're in the restaurant, the bar, in housekeeping, when you have that moment to help educate your guest, the person you're speaking to or taking care of, with some information, it's invaluable because they may or may not have ever known that without your touch. So that's what number four is. Number five is arrive and respond with confidence. And confidence I have bolded in pink because to me, this is the best behavior that I love to see in people. I can read confidence. I can read nervousness. We're all really great at that. I have an exercise where I just act out different emotions and behaviors. And in milliseconds, people can read that emotion. And the one that they get as well is confidence when I demonstrate confidence. And confidence is impressive. And if you arrive to that situation with confidence, you immediately put that guest at ease and you build their confidence because they now know that you are going to be able to answer their question, find an answer to their question, take care of their request, report something that isn't quite working properly. And so there's a trust element that just rises. It rises very quickly when I'm dealing with someone that is confident on the other end of a telephone line or standing on the other end of the desk from me. So these five pieces, if you take away one slide today, I think this is the one that I want you to actually run and kind of embed into your head. Because if you do these five elements, you will work towards that proactive being and culture creator that I know is so powerful in our industry. So here is a slide with a lot of words on it, and I won't bore you with all the detail, but there's a couple of pieces in here that absolutely are riveting to me. And this is a great slide that I use when I'm working on some of my Forbes projects. And it says, understanding the distinction between service and hospitality has been at the foundation of our success. And this is a quote from Danny Meyer, a great leader in the industry. He goes on to say, service is a technical delivery of a product. Hospitality, on the other hand, is how the delivery of that product makes the recipient feel. So this goes back to that slide related to emotions and senses. Service is a monologue. We decide how we need to do things. We set standards for service. Every good company has very solid standards that are known and trained to. Hospitality, on the other hand, is interactive. It's a conversation. And to be on that guest side requires us listening to that guest and responding in a thoughtful and gracious way. The best companies, top performers in the world that I've had a chance and privilege to work with have both great service and great hospitality. I've seen just great service. We've all seen great service, right? Great service is that place that you go and it's very efficient. It's very technically sound. The service staff is well-trained. They are efficient, but you never connect to it. And that's okay. I mean, that's okay, except that's not going to be luxury because it's missing the emotional component. And then we've been to that place that is great on hospitality. And I always use the example of, you go to a restaurant, and have you ever gone to a restaurant with a friend, and you're excited to take them there, but you always qualify it and you say, so I love this place. This restaurant is phenomenal. The service is a little hit and miss, but you know, the food's delicious. The music and the vibe is great. It's going to be a good time. That one statement about the service is a little hit and miss means that on the hospitality front, they make you feel special. And that's a beautiful thing. But if the service is hit and miss, that means it's not consistent. That means the delivery of that service is not sound. And in order to really, you know, march a culture up to that top level, that 4-star level, 5-star level, 5-diamond level, Michelin rated level, it's really about having efficiencies, technical excellence, and most importantly, hospitality. Those are the two elements that bring an experience together. And I usually get a wow moment when I'm working with general managers and I reveal this slide, because they're like, yes, you know what? We're pretty good on the hospitality front, but our service could be stronger. And I fully understand it. I think we all see that when we go into places of business. They many times are stronger in one or the other. And if you are strong in both, then you're memorable. And that gets you to a lot of great places and ratings and all that good stuff. Now, in our next slide, luxury service is thoughtful. And what I mean by thoughtful is it's one of those situations where you've thought ahead of that guest, or you wanted to do something nice for them. And a lot of times when I'm working with service providers, this goes back to reading the guest. You know, you can tell when a guest is excited, and if you send through a congratulations card because you realize that they were a little extra excited, and then you discover it's their honeymoon or they're celebrating a reunion with some friends they haven't seen in a long time, and you send a nice note up to their room, or maybe a couple of strawberries or a bottle of champagne. Those are thoughtful gestures that hit the heart. So again, when in a luxury environment, you will see thoughtfulness as a premier gesture. Luxury service is also, on the next slide, interesting is an interesting word. It's one of my favorite words, and I use it a lot of different ways, and I know you know exactly what I'm talking about. You've heard someone say, that's interesting, and we know exactly what that means. It's questionable. You're unsure about it, but the other and more important kind of meaning of that word is when it's fascinating, it's captivating, it has some sort of energy to it. And so, you know, one of the things that the top cultures in the world appreciate is they love interesting things. And this can be from, you know, an amenity that is offered to, you know, even just a charging plate. One of my most memorable environments, I'll get asked this question often, which is, what is the best hotel you've ever been to? And I always think to myself, that's such a loaded question. And in many ways, it's almost an impossible question to answer, because I find greatness in a lot of things, in a lot of places. And even if it's just a nugget or a grain of greatness, you know, I appreciate it because someone had to deliver that, had to create that. But one property I went to in Shanghai was very interesting. And it was interesting from the arrival all the way through the check-in process, my welcome amenity. I was walking to the pool bar to have a, you know, just to kind of explore the property. And I walked through the dining room of the restaurant that wasn't quite open for service yet. And I'll never forget the charger plates, which is that plate that just sits and decorates the table until the meal comes about, was striking. It was just a profile of a lovely woman. And she had on like a flare dress. It was a yellow dress that flared out, and it was a profile picture of her. And then on the next plate, it was a lady in a pink dress kind of flaring out, and then a blue dress. And each charger plate was unique and interesting. And I just remember thinking, oh my goodness, if I was dining here right now, I wouldn't want that charger plate to go away, because it's adding such beauty to the table. And it was obviously a high quality piece, but it was interesting at its core, because it connected me to that place, that sense of place that I was at in that hotel in Shanghai. And so interesting is always wonderful, and it can be done with bar snacks. It can be done with the way that you offer turndown or evening service. It can be done with the way that you simply provide information, if you're the concierge, on what that guest can do for that day, because they all of a sudden have 2 hours of a window that has opened up. So interesting is a great thing to pursue, make sure we're doing. The next slide.
Hey, Bernie.
Says, yes.
Yes, so we do.
Yes, I can hear you now.
Wonderful, wonderful. We do have a question from the audience.
Of course.
From Sean, what's the biggest challenge in making food service also consistent service?
Food service consistent?
I'm sorry, what's the biggest challenge in making good service also consistent service?
Oh, good service, consistent service. Well, I think good service can be, you know, to Sean's question, can just be a one-off. I can have a good experience, but consistency of that good service comes back to training. It comes back to confidence, and it comes back to the culture, because the culture itself, no matter if it's whatever type of part of the industry it's in, needs to feed that consistency. So the culture might be good enough for a one-off good experience, but when a culture is hitting on all cylinders and it's reinforcing the culture, it's recognizing people who deliver, you know, consistently good service, and it has strong leaders that coach and nourish and give feedback so that people that are delivering the service know that they're doing well. And also, if they misstep, you know, what is the expectation? So to me, it's good service goes to great service when the culture is healthy. And that is a culture of training, feedback, coaching, and recognition.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Of course. And the next slide says that luxury service is well put together or impressive. So this speaks to presentation. And, you know, this is where, you know, when I've worked in great cultures like Forbes, Freeman Group, different hotels, Starwood, now Marriott, they've always had standards of presentation, because they want people to be, you know, impressive in their presentation when they're delivering the service. And so this goes back to the elements of the way that you maintain yourself or something is put together. So to me, you know, luxury service there's an eye attached to it. And if I see something that looks impressive, whether it's a drink presentation or it's the person delivering that drink, that is part of the luxury experience as well. And the next slide says luxury service is the right service or intuitive. And I've alluded to this a little bit earlier, in that if I've just had a long journey and I'm checking into a hotel And someone realizes and catches on to that and says, Mr. Vasquez, I know you've had a long flight and a long day. If I may just have a couple of pieces of information from you, and then we'll get you up to your room so you can start your rest. That is the right service. That's intuitive service. Because normally they would be expected to do the full-on orientation of the property and all those other pieces that we know that they should be doing per their service standards, but they flex their service. And this goes back to that word adventurous, right? A courageous culture. A five-star culture is courageous because it lets people flex. And you have to be, as a leader, willing to allow your people to do that. And as a service professional, you have to take those leaps at times. So intuitive service sometimes requires us to step out of the normal protocol and act on the moment that we're feeling from that guest, you know, from words, from look, from feel. And so that's the intuitive part. The next slide says luxury service is organized and seamless. When I work with a heart of the house department, such as housekeeping or stewarding or the culinary team, they may not have the most direct guest impact with a guest. However, their service is very readily seen. And, you know, when the guest comes back to their room and has their room organized, that in of itself is great service. And that's a luxury because, you know, at their home, they don't have someone necessarily come through and organize things or place their toiletries on a nice underliner mat in the bathroom and organize them from tallest to smallest and make sure the labels are facing them. Those little touches that you do behind the scenes and that the staff does behind the scenes are incredibly powerful. Not to mention, if you're in the culinary world, the concoctions that get created, the creations that get created on the food elements and design can be incredibly impressive. So great service and luxury is organized and seamless, and it sometimes sits behind the scenes, but I let everyone know whether they're in banquets, engineering, or ballet, and they have a lot of first and last impression opportunity, that they are equally important in a luxury experience. And the next slide is that service is relevant and appropriate. Luxury service is relevant and appropriate. I think of this when it comes to those situations where something goes wrong. If something ever goes sideways, and it will because it's hospitality, how we recover and how we respond and react is vital to being able to start bringing that guest back to our side. And sometimes the best we can do is just get another chance with that guest, depending on the situation. And so when we are responding to something, if it's relevant, if it's appropriate, we can actually make that that factor happen sooner than later. And so that's what I mean by luxury service is relevant and appropriate. It has to be right. It has to be the right amenity. It has to be the right recovery. It has to be the right effort. And if we're concentrating on that, that can add to the luxuriousness of an experience. And our next slide is that it's a surprise. And so the surprise factor, I think we all get and realize, oh yes, you know, the complimentary bottle of champagne, but it always stems from somewhere. It's perhaps something that I mentioned on a call, maybe during the reservation process, and it got passed along, noted, and something was offered or gestured upon arrival or during my stay. And whenever I have something like that happen, I realize that that doesn't just happen. It means that the team internally in that luxury experience, they have good communication skills. They pass things along well. You know, it's something that I don't test necessarily, but I definitely, due to my experience, when I see it, I actually appreciate it because I know things don't just happen behind the scenes, or gestures don't just, you know, magically occur. It had to have hit somebody's ear, and now it's just a matter of, let's take this next step and act on it. And I'm going to show some pictures in just a moment, which will show how this happened for me directly. Next slide, please. So we'll go through, I'm going to actually go to the next slide, and you'll see that if I'm in Las Vegas, where we're at, it's such a dynamic destination. These are the guests you're encountering many times, and then many more. But let's go to the next slide, and you'll see a business traveler. And the business traveler, you know, before they decide, let's say they're coming to Vegas for a meeting, there's going to be certain things that they want in that place they choose to stay. And so in one of my exercises, I like to actually, you know, as a business traveler, say, okay, a business traveler probably is going to be looking at location, maybe services or facilities. There's a number of things. The needs is sometimes once I get on property and I'm a business traveler, I need a place to conduct a meeting, or, you know, maybe have a nice dinner and have almost a hybrid dinner meeting. I would like a fitness center because I'm going to be eating and socializing a lot. So I'll need that. So the expectations quadrant of this particular exercise I walk my colleagues through is, what do they expect of me? Because a business traveler will have some different expectations of me. Excuse me. If I'm the service provider, I will have different expectations of that service provider than if I'm traveling with my family on a holiday, leisure travel. I'm going to have some very specific things I would like from that service professional, such as maybe attentiveness, reactiveness, knowledge, because I'm going to be coming to that desk, engaging with the staff via phone, and I'm going to need some things, and I want them to be confident. And the emotional component of the quadrant is really when you do all these things well, how it hits the mark, how I feel. And a lot of times a business traveler is pretty low maintenance, and I don't mean that the word maintenance sounds negative. What I mean, they're very self-sufficient, a business traveler. But what I do say is that with a business traveler, nothing can really go wrong. They can't have a missed wake-up call or pressing service that comes back late. All the pieces need to be in order for a business traveler to be successful. And if you were to do this exercise with the different types of guests that I have on the previous screen, they would have different wants, needs, expectations, and emotions, wouldn't they? And that leads to the next slide, which is more. And the more component is, what do I do for this business traveler or this international traveler or this gaming guest or this sports enthusiast? What do I do that is above and beyond, maybe that they didn't expect, and that I took that courageous step and made something happen? So I love doing that exercise with different types of guests that I deal with, because that helps me realize that it's all about the personalization. That's where everything happens. So the final few slides. Next, we'll have the sense of place. You can see that this was actually in a couple of places. You can see the Pearl Tower in Shanghai on the right. But that particular hotel, the Ritz-Carlton, used its location as a sense of place to maximize, like, we're going to sit you. There were tables and chairs right near this railing. So they had an outdoor patio. I mean, just so high up in the air, looking out at that beautiful scene. And then in London, you can see that the mini bar was stocked with a lot of local products so that I could begin to taste the culture as someone who was visiting that particular hotel. The next slide talks a little bit about the organization, and this is the heart of the house, the silent servers that are so amazing and what they do, and just doing little touches, and look at the meticulousness that goes into that. That's something that I don't do at home when I'm staying by myself. And so when you do that, you're offering a luxury to me because you're helping me be organized. The next slide is about creativity. And in the food and beverage world, you'll see this is a tea, just basically a tea cart stand, essentially. And just the design of the food and the design of the actual structure, you know, everything is thought out as it gets put into service. And that's a luxurious element, because now you're bringing the food and the food and beverage quality and element into it and mixing it with the actual serviceware. The next slide talks a little, this is one of my favorite surprises, because as a Manchester United fan, and I was checking into a hotel in London, right in Chelsea territory, for those of you who are Premier League fans, it was fantastic because they noticed that I was a Man U fan just from the duffel bag that I was carrying. And I was looking for a pub to go watch the game. It was the opening game of the season. I found a pub not too far away. And by the time I got back, I had this placard with some chocolates and some beers and some, you know, still water. And it was just one of those things that was like, wow, you know, they just noticed something that might warm my heart. And by the time I got back a couple of hours later, they had put it into motion. And so surprises are luxurious during this day. And the next slide is thoughtful. And again, on the left-hand side, you'll see a welcome amenity at the Barclay Hotel. This is also where the Manchester United amenity came up for my turndown. And this is just, again, not anything that is, that whole welcome piece is just so interesting, isn't it? It's these encased boxes with, you know, different types of biscuits in there, and then some fruit. Everything is well-designed, logoed, branded, and it's meant to create a sense of distinction. You don't get that at every place that you arrive at, and that is their welcome amenity for every single guest. On the right-hand side, you know, this is was Hotel Icon, and you'll appreciate this as a final thought. This is a hotel that's a hotel school in Hong Kong, and they're not seeking any kind of rating designation. Their students are just trying to go through the programs and get to a graduation level. And I was spending my birthday out in Asia this particular year, and I was a little bit kind of like sad inside, because I had thought it was not going to be a big deal. My birthday was on a Monday that year, and I was like, oh, I'll just be overseas, it's no big deal. And then all of a sudden you get to your birthday and you're like, you know, I kind of wish I had someone to go to dinner with, or, you know, something. And at checkout, my birthday was the next day, this was a Sunday, this young lady pops this box up on top of the counter and says, oh, Mr. Vasquez, we noticed your birthday was tomorrow. And we just wanted to leave you with a couple of cupcakes from our Green Cafe. This is a matcha tea cupcake as well as a chocolate cupcake. And thank you for staying with us. And I was just so hit the heart, because it was one of those moments that it just collided with my emotion of being a little bit sad that I was spending my birthday alone. I didn't have any friends out there at that time. But boy, I opened it up and it's gorgeous. And this is a hotel school. And it took that one young lady just noticing my birthday from my passport to jump into action. And I went to my 5-star the next day, and I'm not one to trumpet my birthday. And so that next day, no one knew it was my birthday. And so it shows that great service can be executed upon by anyone. And lastly, I think I've got maybe one more slide, impressive presentations. And these are just some of the great colleagues I've had a chance to work with. But again, look at how well put together, from a posture, from an attention, from a uniform, you know, they look ready to go. And that gentleman on the right hand, the bottom right hand, that's Kuhn. He was our very first intern when we started the company, and just a tremendous young man that was just, you know, he caught my eye, as did all these different professionals. And I stayed in touch with them and was able to stay connected with them over the years. So be impressive in your presentation and act on a lot of those things we chatted about earlier. And you can't go wrong with creating luxury in all that you do. And the last line is just a thank you. And so I will turn it back to Anthony.
All right, thank you, Bernie. So we do have a few minutes left for Q&A. So please type in your question either on the Q&A feature or on our chat feature. In the meantime, if you do miss a portion of this recording, I do apologize for the little brief rough start, but we seem like we got a little bit smooth sailing going.
Great.
On to the next few slides. But if you do miss a portion, please subscribe to us at TISO channel. The recording will be uploaded on our TISO social media, including our Facebook, LinkedIn, as well as our YouTube channel. Bernie, while I have you on here, any of our audience does have questions, what is the best way for them to reach out to you? Do you have
any? Oh, yes, they can reach out to me via email. I'd be happy to share that email. And shall I just give that to you now? It's bvasquez@polishedservicellc.com. Best way, and let me see, I can pop it right in here. And feel free to reach out to me with any questions. I love receiving them. I stay connected with a lot of people around the globe as we all have an all hands on deck approach to the rebuild of this industry after what we've been through. And I really love hearing about people's growth and experiences and just sharing, because I learn from you and what you get a chance to go out and do and who you get to impact.
All right, thank you, Bernie. And thank you, audience, for joining us. Please continue to visit tisonow.com or tisonext.com for our alums if you want to stay up to date on the latest news and happenings at TISO. Have a wonderful afternoon, everyone.
Thank you, good day.
Oh, it looks like we do have a question.
Okay.
The word luxury equals costly. Does service have to be expensive?
No, it doesn't. It doesn't. Luxury, and that's the part of the luxury part that I've had a dislike relationship with, because it can sound expensive and it sounds like it's a lot of free stuff. And luxury is really about, it's an awareness and it's an action. It can be a conversation, it can be an act. And so when I show those pictures of just doing something luxurious in normal service, in the guest room, that doesn't cost much. It just takes a little bit of effort and knowing that that would make a nice impact. And so it doesn't always have to include bottles of champagne and wines and chocolates and all kinds of things that, you know, especially as we rebuild, take away from the revenue line. It can be as simple as starting a conversation. I had a ride on the shuttle bus this morning to my Hertz rental car. And the gentleman stuck out to me simply because he welcomed me onto the bus. He, asked how my flight was and my morning was going. On arrival, he showed me and directed me to the board where my name was listed for my vehicle and which slot it was in. And he was just doing this all on his own. And so that to me is a luxury act that didn't cost him anything. He just struck me as someone that really enjoyed his job. And that's why I say I've really come to think differently about what luxury is all about. It doesn't have to be expensive.
Exactly, I couldn't agree more. And you mentioned in your some of the previous PowerPoints that luxury is thoughtful, luxury is a surprise, but there's nothing on there that says luxury comes at a cost.
Right, right. So it's a great way to for me to have changed my mind on that thinking, because otherwise it can be a turnoff. And I don't like to think of luxury as anything but special and caring and making me feel good. And so that when we're in our roles as service leaders, we have a lot of power.
Absolutely. All right, so right now it is getting close to 3 p.m. Again, thank you again, Bernie, for your time. I'm sure a lot of us got some great takeaways on secrets to luxury service. Just to repeat one more time, if you do miss a recording of this webinar, subscribe to us at TISO channel, as well as our Facebook and our LinkedIn page. Have a great day.
Thank you, everyone.